So welcome to the program. We will have four examiners and two analyzers as usual. Our senior most professors, Dr. Professor P. Rajan sir and Dayanandabab sir already joined here. And from outside state, that is from Delhi, we got Ajit Sinha. He is a professor of the SGT Medical Gurugram. And our other examiners are Joji Malikil. Not joined is for Professor of Surgery, MES Medical College, Pendalamanna, and Ajay Kumar, Professor of Surgery, Government Medical Calicut, and also Sri Kumar. He is a well known vascular surgeon. He has initially worked in the Sriyatra and he rejoined in Government Medical Trivandrum. He is a well known figure in Trivandrum and ever Kerala, all in all India, say. ASI, Kerala State Chairman, and very active in IMA activities and in the teaching field. So welcome to all the examiners. We'll go. I also welcome the our students. Today is Mohsin VK. He's a third year JR from ACCI Medical Kollam. And also welcome to all the students from Kerala. And we are at our program that is start with a case of vascular disease. So Mohsin,
sir.
I think you can start. Join sir. Join sir will join. Later.
Okay, Mohsin, please start.
Good evening, all. Respected faculties and my dear friends. Today I am going to present a case of POVD. Myself, I am Dr. Mohsin. Second year junior resident in general surgery, ACCI Institute of Medical Science and Research, Kollam. And going to the case presentation, my patient, chief complaints are, my patient is Mr. X, a 75-year-old gentleman. He is a manual laborer and he is hailing from Anjal in Kollam, and he is from a low socioeconomic class. And his chief complaints are. Pain in the right calf for the past 1 year and blackish discoloration of right big toe for the past 3 months. History of present illness. He is having claudication pain. Initially, pain was in the right calf region. Cramping pain associated with numbness and pain disappears with while he stops walking. He could walk about 250 meters without pain, but gradually the distance reduced. At present, he can walk only 10 meters distance without pain for the last 3 months. He also has continuous dull aching pain in the right foot, which disturbs his sleep. And pain more at night and lying down position. Has some relief on hanging or flexing the limb. Also noticed blackish discoloration of right big toe. Initially, the discoloration was seen on the tip of great toe, which later progressed to involve the whole of the right big toe. No history of pain, swelling, and discoloration. Along the course of superficial veins, no history of pain over gluteal region of thigh, no history of trauma or ulceration, no history of chest pain or dyspnea on exertion, no history of pain, pallor or discoloration on exposure to cold, no history of blackout or syncope, no history of blurring of vision, no history of weakness of limbs, no history of abdominal pain or other GI symptoms, no history of impotence. Coming to the past history, he has dyslipidemia for the past 10 years and he is on statins. No history of systemic hypertension, diabetes mellitus, no history of bronchial asthma, COPD, no history of tuberculosis, coronary artery disease, stroke or seizure disorders. And coming to the personal history, he is taking mixed diet and normal appetite. Sleep is reduced due to his pain in the foot. And he is a smoker for 30 years. He smokes 10 to 15 cigarettes per day and continuing smoking. Takes alcohol occasionally. His bowel and bladder habits regular. And his family history: parents died of old age related illness. And he has three siblings. No history of diabetes, coronary artery disease, cerebrovascular accidents, or similar illness in the family. Coming to the drug and allergic histories, he's on statins for the past 10 years, and no history of allergy to any drugs or dust. And summary of my history is: 75-year-old male. Smoker with dyslipidemia, presented with claudication over right calf, chest pain, and blackish discoloration of right big toe. coming to the physical examination. On general examination, the patient is moderately built and nourished. His BMI is 20, pallor plus and no icterus or cyanosis.
No, Hussein.
Sir.
Wait, I will go to examination regarding your history taking. So, Professor Ajit Singh, sir, what about the his candidate history regarding the cases?
He has not talked about any loss of muscle in the leg or thinness or loss of hair in the history.
Yes. Anything else? Srikumar, anything you want to add to the history? Srikumar?
Can you go to the first slide, please?
Ah, first slide.
Yeah. Okay. Why there is any insight about the history of edema? Is there edema?
Sir, it is due to the angle of the photograph. It is not that edematous.
It's not edematous. The toes like are normal.
Normal, sir.
Okay. The picture is normal. Okay. Next slide, please. You said the patient is on statins for last 10 years, but why the patient has put on statins for 10 years?
Sir, he is 10 years back on his routine checkup, he found out to be dyslipidemic and started from outside. Some physicians started on atorvastatin 10 mg/hs.
Okay. What are the features of claudication pain? You said the patient is having claudication.
Yes, sir. The pain will start on exercise, and pain will relieve after taking rest of about 5 minutes. The pain will not start on the first step. It will start after taking a few steps.
Okay. Any other features?
It is always reproducible.
Okay.
It is cramping like type of pain.
Okay. Okay. One more. You are perfect.
Sir, he is having the pain in the right calf region.
Yes, the type of tissue happens is the muscles. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Can you give me some example of pseudo claudications?
Sir, there is venous claudication. It will be usually a bursting type of pain, and neurogenic claudication.
What are the features of venous claudication? One is burst type of pain. Any other difference with the?
The pain will be more towards evening.
Okay.
It will be along the course of the veins, superficial veins, and
The course of veins. What's the common site of venous claudication?
The gaiteous area, that is in the lower part of the leg.
No. It occurs around the knee joint, just below the knee joint, is the common site. What activity aggravates venous claudication?
Prolonged standing.
Okay. Good. Yes. Next slide, please. Yes, please. Why there is continuous pain in the foot?
Sir, he is having rest pain for the last 3 months.
Rest pain is a continuous pain in the foot muscles.
Yes, sir. Continuous pain. It will not be relieved by regular analgesics.
What is the rest pain? Can you define rest pain features?
Sir, the pain will be more on the distal part of the limb, that is, or the.
Is it a toes?
Yes, sir.
Is it toes?
Forefoot and toes.
Toes is a type of what type of tissue? It's a common site of rest pain.
Sir,
it's a common site of rest pain.
The distal most part. If the patient is having gangrene, then it will be at the margin of the viable and non-viable tissue.
That is pain due to gangrene, not due to rest pain.
Rest pain will be in the distal most part, sir, in the digits.
Is the toes or the midfoot?
Sir, both in the midfoot and torso.
But mostly in the midfoot. That's the common site. Unless there is some infection. Okay. What are any other evidence of chronic ischemia in this patient?
Sir, he's having rest pain.
Okay, that's there. Pain. Yes. Ask and, Dr. Addison asked. Ah.
Sir, black is discoloration of right big toe.
Okay.
He's in the examination, I will mention that his skin coming to that, sir. His skin is
not shiny. Not the examination. That history part. What are the evidence of ischemia in that foot?
There will be pain.
Pain is not that evidence. Okay.
There will be pallor.
Pallor, patient won't.
Sir, loss of hair.
Loss of hair. I agree.
Loss of subcutaneous fat, thereby skin becoming thin, shiny okay. Skin.
You okay.
Skin becomes fine. Shiny.
Yeah. Then.
Then the skin will be dry.
Okay. Changes in muscles.
There will be wasting of muscles, sir.
Okay. So, did you ask for any history of systemic involvement of vascular disease patients on statin for last 10 years?
Say, yes, sir.
What are the?
He has no history of chest pain, dyspnea on exertion.
Okay.
To rule out cardiac involvement, sir. And okay. He has no. Sir.
Okay, please.
Sir, no what history is of blackout.
Okay.
Blackout.
What is? What is blackout?
To roll out transient ischemic attack, sir.
What is TIA?
It
can you define TIA or features of TIA?
It will be a transient insult.
Transient means? Transient means?
It will resolve within 24 hours.
Okay, then? Somebody said it's 72 hours, it is not, it is 24 hours. Okay, fine.
Yes, now we will go to Ajay Kumar. What are the history? Into you want to add?
Yes. Oksin, it was almost a complete history. A few clarifications. You said the claudication distance at present is 10 meters. And you yourself said it is rest pain. Rest pain is the final culmination. Once rest pain starts, patient cannot even walk a single step. That is the usual phenomenon we observe. So you have to keep in mind when you present in the examination. So it is better to avoid the the claudication distance like 10 feet or 15 feet when you describe respect, number one. Number two, how will you differentiate between a neurogenic claudication and a vascular claudication? A question.
Sir, neurological claudication will not resolve on taking rest. While arterial claudication will resolve after taking rest, approximately 5 minutes after taking rest, the pain will resolve.
That's the only point. Anything else?
The neurological claudication will be shooting type of pain, while the arterial claudication will be cramping type of pain.
Yeah, classical description is when the patient starts walking, in the first
step itself,
neurogenic claudication pain starts. And it will never be relieved by walk. After some time, it relieves. See, after initial a few steps or after some time, it may be relieved. Whereas vascular claudication will not start in the first step or first few steps. After some time, that is the after the possible shortest claudication distance. Then when you take rest, it will disappear. These are the two points. One you say. Okay.
And another one more point, just to complete the condition. Vascular claudication has no relation with the position of the patient or position of the limb. But neurogenic claudication has the relation to some particular position of the patient or position of the limb. That's another feature.
Okay. So, adding to what Srikumar said, the cause of vascular claudication may vary depending on many causes like vascular disease or the neurological system, can be a mechanical compression of the exiting nerve, so many causes. So depending on that, the position may aggravate. For example, some patient will have more pain while sitting, isn't it? Bending, those things are not there in vascular claudication.
Yes, exactly.
Let me ask you.
Yes.
Can you just
continue?
Yes, sir.
Ajay, continue. What do you want?
One more question. A patient with all features of vascular disease, that is peripheral occlusive vascular disease with distal gangrene like this, okay, but there is no pain. Is it possible?
What's the answer?
Age of, if the patient has an age of, if he is an young patient, there can be acrocyanosis. In such case, there it will be painless.
Ajay Kumar, you can answer that question.
Moksil, I am taking you to a associated condition or comorbidity. Suppose this patient has got dislikely
diabetes
together.
Diabetes.
Suppose he is a diabetic for the past 20 years. What would you?
So then he will have diabetic peripheral neuropathy. So then he can have a painless, resolve symptoms with a painless condition.
It will destroy all pain transmitting fibers. So it is an additional danger because patient will come to know about it very late.
Very late.
Gangrene will be very far above. But here the sensation is intact. And the cry of the dying nerves, that is the rest pain. In the patient, I have severe COPD. He will seek treatment. That is very important. Okay.
Mohsin, I want to add on the history. One point, you mentioned drug statins. Also, you should mention regarding the migraines. Drugs used for migraine can produce the vasospasm. Which drug can produce? What drug produce vasospasm? Use for migraine, ergots. Another thing, the rest pain, usually rest pain is more aggravated night. And the patient will hanging down their legs from the bed. That is a classical picture. And why there is a rest pain aggravated night? Disturb the sleep.
One thing, the patient will be, most of the time, he will be walking or hanging down the limb during the daytime. And he will not be that much aware of the pain. Sir, during the night time, he will be more aware of the pain.
During the night time, heart rate will be reduced. So then the cardio output will be reduced and the hypoxia will be aggravated. That is why rest pain, the aggravated night. Okay, I think we discussed the history well. Then we go to the...
One more point to be added. When you ask the history, you are asking about blackouts. Blackouts may be a vascular impediment of the posterior circulation. It can be a carotid or plaque. Those things, by altering the position of the neck and all, you may get dimness of vision. So blackout need not be always TIA or RIND. What is RIND?
Reversible ischemic
deficit. That is up to 1 week. As we said, it is 24 TAA, and if it lasts for more and it reverses without any deficit, it is called RIND. So, vertigo is an important symptom in such patients. So, cardiology and neurology symptoms are very, very important in any peripheral occlusive vascular disease. Okay, carry on.
So now you go to examination.
Coming to the general examination, he is a moderately built and nourished. His BMI is 20. He is having pallor, no icterus or cyanosis. He is having grade 2 clubbing and no generalized lymphadenopathy. He is afebrile. Pulse rate is 88 per minute in right radial artery with regular rhythm, normal volume and character. Condition of vessel wall is normal, no radiofemoral delay. His blood pressure is 130/80 in right arm and 120/70 in left arm and 106/70 in left angle in supine position. Respiratory rate is 18 per minute, regular abdominothoracic. And coming to the local examination, his left lower limb appears to be normal, and on inspection of the right lower limb, his attitude of the limbs neutral, no deformity of toes and digit, wasting of muscles present, guttering of veins seen, and thinning of skin present. Loss of hair and subcutaneous fat, skin is shiny, nails appear brittle with transverse ridges, no ulceration, no erythema, abnormal pigmentation of the skin. Burgess postural test and capillary filling time has not done because of the dark complexion of the patient. Venous refilling is delayed. Blackish, dry, shriveled, mummified right big toe with demarcation seen at the level of interphalangeal joint. Peeling of skin over right big toe, surrounding skin dry. And on palpation of right lower limb, inspection finding confirmed, and is called to touch below knee. Capillary refilling is delayed, movement of joint normal, venous refilling is delayed, blackish discoloration of right big toe with line of demarcation seen at the level of interphalangeal joint, no tenderness and sensation felt over right big toe, no crepitus or edema around the right big toe, full range of movement at the metatarsophalangeal joint, an examination of the motor system, normal tone in both limbs, power is full in both limbs, and right side muscle bulk is reduced. An examination of sensory system reveals there is a mild decrease in right side on for touch pain and temperature. Coming to the peripheral pulsations, superficial temporal carotid, subclavian and axillary and brachial pulses are felt equally on both sides. And radial pulses and ulnar pulses and femoral pulses felt equally on both sides. Popliteal pulse is not felt on the right side. Anterior tibial artery and posterior tibial artery not felt on right side, which is feeble in the left side. Dorsalis pedis also not felt on right side, which is feeble on the left side. And other system examination of the abdomen is soft and non-tender, no mass palpable, no bruvi. An examination of the CVS, normal precordium, both heart sounds heard normally and no murmurs. Examination of the central nervous system, higher mental functions normal, no focal neurological deficit. Examination of the respiratory system, trachea central, air entry bilaterally equal, no added sounds, skull and spine examination within normal limits. Coming to the summary, a 75-year-old male smoker with dyslipidemia presented with pain over right leg, rest pain and blackish discoloration of right big toe. On examination, right leg showing signs of vascular insufficiency and blackish discoloration of right toe with absent pulsations below the level of femoral artery.
So, hello, what is your diagnosis? What is your diagnosis?
Sir, diagnosis, peripheral occlusive vascular disease of right lower limb with ischemic ganglion of right big toe, probably atherosclerotic, and level of occlusion at right femoropopliteal segment.
I think Joy sir is joined. Joy sir.
You said the femoral pulse is absent. Totally absent.
No,
the
present.
Femoral pulse is present, sir.
Femoral is present. How do you look for popliteal pulsation?
There are three techniques. One is patient in supine position. Flex the knee at 135 degree with heel at the bottom and palpate the pulse in the lower part of the popliteal fossa against the tibial posterior surface of the tibia, upper part of the tibia. And the next one is most convenient.
Okay. You look for...
Sir, I can hear you, sir.
Yes, sir. You repeat your question.
Have you looked for bruin in any other area than the abdomen? Will you look for bruin in the groin?
Yes, sir. To know if there is any occlusion in the proximal to femoral artery, sir.
What is the significance of bruin?
Sir, if bruin, sir, there will be an occlusion proximal to that part, sir. If we hear bruin in the femoral, at the area of femoral pulse, then there is a chance for stenosis, occlusion in the external iliac or common iliac.
Proximal part, okay.
You said about muscle wasting.
Yes, sir.
You didn't mention which part of which muscle actually exactly is wasted. Is the thigh muscle or the calf muscle?
Calf muscle, sir.
What about the foot muscles?
Sir, from below the calf, it is wasted, sir. From below the calf to foot.
You did not specify any particular group, you know. Isn't it important?
Yes, sir.
How did you find that it is atrophic? How did you, can you significantly tell positively? Did you do any test for that?
Sir, we can measure the muscle bulk.
Did you measure it?
Yes, sir.
So, what difference you found? Which level you found?
Sir, there was a difference of 4 centimeter difference from right and left in the calf region, sir.
No, is it a...
How do you measure it? How do you properly measure it? How is the procedure?
Sir, patient in supine position, we will measure the... We will mark the area on both limbs at the same level in the calf region. And we will take the circumferential measurement using a tape.
What is anatomy point?
How do you take the same level? What is the point? Yes. How do you take that same level?
Sir, 10 centimeter from the tibial tuberosity.
10 centimeter will be a little low.
You prefer a upper area or lower segment for muscle wasting?
Sir, I.
You prefer the upper segment or lower segment?
Upper segment.
Why?
Bulk is more in the upper segment.
Muscle mass is more, no?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Your problem is 10 centimeter. You mentioned 10. Any textbooks given the 10 centimeter below the tibial tuberosity?
That will be very low.
What is the ideal centimeter you should take?
I don't know, sir.
From tibial tuberosity. Is that minimum 5 centimeter? Not better, more than 5.
Not that's more than 5. 5, 6 centimeter from the tibial tuberosity.
Yes. That's all right.
Then you mark that area and then you measure. And what is the significant difference in the muscle mass? What diameter is less? 1 centimeter, 2 centimeter, 3 centimeter? What? Which one will you say significant distance difference?
More than 2 centimeters.
Is it more than 1 centimeter, more than 2 centimeter, more than 3 centimeter?
2, sir.
Two. Don't know. Did you look for the muscle changes in calf also, foot also? How do you look
By looking, it is decreased on by comparing on either sides.
Did you see the sole also of the person?
Yes, sir.
Sole of the foot. Did you find any difference in the sole of the foot also?
Yes, sir.
Plantar surface.
Yes.
What difference did you find?
Sir, there is clawing of toes.
Why do you say clawing of toes? Why? What does it signify?
Sir,
you didn't see carefully. You didn't see carefully. You know. See again, you will realize. Compare the two legs.
Yeah, show that picture of leg.
So there is definitely edema over the distal part of the toes and the dorsum of the toe. Foot.
Yes, that's my first question. How would we assess edema of the leg?
Sir, by pressing over the medial malleolus.
Yes.
If there is leaking pedal edema, then it will not.
That is one method. That's when you are looking edema at the middle malleolus. How will you see
the edema ankle?
Other areas. Yes. Ankle. That's here. Here the picture is the toes only. How do you know that's edematous or not? There is no edema. Yes. One is you can look at the opposite limb, see that.
Compare the limb.
Yes. Second is you look at the skin. Is it stretched or not?
Stretches.
You can see the skin is stretched.
The fingers and toes.
Yes. Toes and just above the toes also is stretched. The wrinkles are absent in some areas. The toes and all. Third is you can apply pressure over it, whether it is dipping or not. So the history you said there is no edema, but on look itself there is edema of the limb. Why there is edema? What are the cause of edema in this patient?
Why is there edema?
It can be due to venous congestion, sir.
No. Venous congestion, why? Why there is venous congestion in this patient? Already the blood reaching there is very limited. The vein is normally, obviously normal. There's no disease of the veins. Or you want to change, if you are thinking about venous congestion, you want to change your diagnosis?
No, sir. No, sir.
Yes or no?
No, sir.
Can any arterial disease produce a venous disease?
Yes, sir. A Burgess disease.
Yes. So you go for a Burgess disease
patient? No, sir. He's 75 years age. And,
okay, agree. So what are the cause of edema in this patient?
Can be due to infection.
Yes, one is infection, post-inflammatory changes. Yes.
Because of capillary dilatation and more tissue perfusion.
Yes. Second doctor is asked, Dr. Ajit Sinha said, there may be capillary dilatation producing more perfusion due to autonomic changes. Is he a diabetic?
No, sir.
Not diabetic.
Yeah?
Not diabetic.
No, he's not diabetic.
Not diabetic. If he's diabetic, what are the causes of edema? A diabetic patient presenting with edema.
Again, can be
again it is due to autonomic changes. Again, it may be capillary dilatation, which is more in diabetic people. Yes. Okay.
Yes, Jay Kumar.
Yeah, Mohsin. A good coverage of all points. A few questions. One is, you have to mention about ABI, angle brachial index, even though the pedal pulses are not at present. Because ABA is a reproducible one. It is a one which is used for follow-up. It is used for pre-op assessment, post-op improvement assessment, everything. So the word ABA should be there. ABA could not be measured because of the absent pedal pulses. The pedal pulses you palpate and tell me how to palpate each.
Dorsalis pedis, it is lateral to the extensalis tendon against the base of first metatarsal and the navicular bone. Anterior tibial, just above the angle at the lower part of the tibia. Peroneal artery pulsation is felt over the medial aspect, medial 1 centimeter medial to the lateral malleolus, and the posterior tibial
artery is usually not felt unless it is the only artery
patent
are gone. Otherwise, in a normal patient, peroneal artery will not be palpable.
Will not be palpable.
Okay, tell me about the anterior tibial.
The anterior tibial is felt over the lower part of the lower part of the under surface of tibia, just above the angle.
No,
against,
no.
Against the head of phallus.
Surface markings and the tendons, a clue in relation to which tendon, and the tibial is in front of the angle, everybody knows. Have you heard of the mnemonics, the Himalayas are never dry places? The structures under the extensor retina. Tell me. the Himalayas are tibial, anterior, extensor hallucis,
hallucis.
Never, no, glide. What is D?
Deep peroneal.
The digitorum, isn't it? P peroneus tertius. So just lateral to the extensor hallucis tendon.
Hallucis tendon.
Move the dicto. See the extensor hallucis tendon. Just lateral to that tendon, in front of the ankle, is the anterior tibial
artery.
Why anterior tibial is more important than dorsalis pedis? Dorsalis pedis may be absent.
Dorsalis pedis will not be present in normally in 10 to 20% of patients.
Whereas anterior tibial, if it is palpable, it is very important. Why? It can have communications with other systems, posterior tibial or peroneal, even if one or two are blocked. Okay. So what is the most important artery of the leg or foot? Sorry, foot. What is the most important artery of the foot?
Anterior tibial.
Posterior tibial. Around 70% of the blood, foot comes through the posterior tibial. What is angiosome? Concept.
Each part is supplied by a single particular angiosome. In leg, there is three angiosomes: anterior, posterior, and lateral. For anterior, it is anterior tibial artery. For posterior, it is posterior tibial artery. For lateral, it is peroneal artery.
Okay, what are the branches of the posterior tibial artery? Branches.
Sir, I didn't hear you, sir.
What are the branches of posterior tibial artery?
Very.
Now we can have facilities to do angioplasties in those branches. That is the level of advancement our vascular intervention has achieved. Very important. And angiosome concept becomes very more important there. Okay.
Most what is angiosome?
What is the importance of angiosome?
It is a unit which is developed from a particular unit artery.
Okay. Just like your dermatome. Importance, yes. Is you may have one artery patent. And you make one artery revascularized by doing a revascularization
procedure
of angioplasty or bypass. But the angiosome concept becomes important there. If the interconnection between these two are not patent, the diagonalis part will not get the blood supply. Understand? The ischemic part will not be revascularized. So if you have a very good imaging modality, you will get even the finer network of arterioles. Okay, so the angiosome concept becomes important in revascularization. We all learned that even if posterior tibial artery is revascularized, you can save the foot. But as Sri Kumar does, even though the how far distal the bypass may be, sometimes it is not effective if the intercommunication is absent.
That point. Hossein, as Dr. Ajayama said, if the pulse is not palpable, will you check for the ABPI?
Yes, sir. By using a handheld Doppler. Sir.
Yes. What is ABPI?
Sir, the angle pressure it is the ratio between angle pressure and to the brachial pressure.
Which brachial, if right lower limb is there, which brachius will you check first?
So we will check both and we will take the highest.
Very good. What is the importance of ABPI?
It is used for the diagnosis, for the, yes, follow-up, and yes, for preoperative assessment. And okay. It can be used for selecting the procedure for the patient, and we can assess the prognosis.
What's the critical ABPI?
Which is a critical
less than 0.5, sir.
Pardon?
Less than 0.5.
Okay. If it's 1.3, you accept it?
Sir, if it is small, then that means a calcified vessel.
Why it's so, increased in calcified vessel?
Sir, we cannot compress it.
Yes.
So it will be falsely high.
Adding to Dr. R.C. Srikumar's question, you do a lot of slough cutting in diabetic foot, isn't it, in our wards?
Yes, sir.
Pounding pulses, both post-tibial, dorsal speed is very bounding, and the blood pressure in the ankle is 200, whereas the brachial blood pressure is 140. Are you happy?
No, sir. It can be a fallacy, sir. I mean, it may be false, sir, because...
Sir? Happy in the sense, are you happy in the expected outcome of the ulcer?
Healing ulcer.
Yeah.
No, sir, because he is having severe calcification of the vessels. So he will be having.
I agree. Ischemia. The blood pressure in the dorsal pedis or posterior tibial or lateral plantar is very high. I agree. Because of the calcification, lead pipe effect, isn't it? But what is the problem? What is the pathological problem occurring in the microcirculation level? That is the reason for non-healing of many ulcers with bounding pulses. That is what point...
There will be microangiopathy, sir.
Yeah, tell me. Can you just explain?
Micro... Sir, voice breaking, sir.
Can you just explain what's the reason for non-healing of ulcer in such a bounding pulse cases?
Sir, there will be diabetic arteriopathy, sir. It will be affecting the media of the micro and arterioles.
Okay, you are nearing the point. Yeah, you try to explain.
So we will get a non-healing ulcer.
Okay, I'll explain little more. As R.C. Srikumar was asking about autonomic neuropathy, take the example of diabetes.
So the patient will be having peripheral neuropathy also, sir.
Yes. So, you know, the capillary bed circulation is controlled by the sympathetic and parasympathetic harmonious activity on which sphincter? Precapillary sphincter. At the distalmost arteriolar level, there is a precapillary sphincter. So, that is controlled by sympathetics and parasympathetics. Suppose you are very shy or if you are having some tender feelings, your cheek will be flushing. Why? Because of the parasympathetic stimulation and dilatation. If you are afraid, you become pale, isn't it? The reason is sympathetic stimulation. What will happen in diabetic foot with a bounding pulse? This high blood pressure will make newer arteriovenous connections just before the level of precapillary sphincter. AV shunts will develop. Understand? This precapillary sphincter will be in a hypersensitive contracted stage. The blood will not reach the capillary circulation. You have a bounding pulse, plenty of blood flowing in within seconds, but it will not reach the capillary bed. It will bypass the capillaries and go to the venous called AV shunts. This is a very well-known or a notorious mechanism by which the delay in ulcer healing with bounding pulse. As a postgraduate, you had to learn this pathophysiology. A bounding pulse or an ABA of 2 is always dangerous than a normal or a feeble pulse and an ABA of 0.8. Did you understand? Okay.
Mohsin, what is segmental pressure and what significance? Have you heard of segmental pressure measurement and its significance? Mohsin?
Mohsin.
What is segmental pressure measurement and how is it significant?
Measuring pressure in a particular artery.
No.
I think you can answer.
In a lower limb, you can measure pressure at three levels. One is upper thigh, lower thigh, and calf muscle, calf area. And if the pressure difference is more than 20 between two segments, you can assume that the obstruction is at that level. That's the one indirect method of finding out the level of obstruction, that segmental pressure measurement. How do you check venous filling in this patient? Because you said capillary filling and venous filling. Is it possible in this patient? That picture?
Sir, there is a guttering of vein, sir. So we can see it is filling up by in patient in supine position, elevating the limbs, there will be guttering. And by lowering down, there will be filling of that vein.
Question, to be honest, it is very difficult to find out capillary filling, blanching in this dark complexion, ischemic limb. So it is capillary filling could not be assessed because of the dark complexion. That is a safe way of putting it in the examination. Number one.
Capillary filling could not be assessed. That I told. And in,
there. You can inspect the limb. Venous filling is most probably not there. I think R.C. Srikumar also will be agreeing with me. Such an ischemic limb from femoral downwards, no flow and rest pain. It is very difficult to get a filled segment of great saphenous vein just in the periosteum, the thin gaiters area where we do the two finger milking and seeing the venous filling. It is very difficult. That is the most important thing. Unless it is a very fair patient, your Burgers test, everything is Burgers angle, those things don't mention in our set of patients. That is the safest.
Okay. Yes. Mohsin, that's a clear I want to mention few things in the general the examination. You should compare the both leg simultaneously regarding any position of the leg, any deformity of the leg, and also you didn't mention about the temperature. Did you mention temperature difference? How will you assess temperature?
Called, sir, it will be
how will you assess? How will you assess?
By using dorsum, sir, first we have to expose the both limbs for at least 5 minutes. Then we will assess using the dorsum of our fingers, simultaneously comparing either limbs, both limbs. Sir.
That okay. is important. You expose both legs together and wait for 5 minutes. And you with your dorsum option. What is the medical term for the difference of temperature?
Poikilothermia, sir.
Okay. And I think your general examination is okay, except this, you should compare both sides. You should show the picture. Both legs are withers exposed and you are palpating. Always compare whether your hair loss, wasting of muscles, everything and color, everything you should compare both sides. It is, that's very important for the physical examination of that leg. And the measurement also you need to be careful. Then we go to examination can go to how you manage. You can ask Srikumar.
One more question, sir, regarding the vascular examination. Mohsin, you mentioned about the pressures, blood pressures in both upper limbs. There is a slight difference, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Can you explain further what would be the reason? And is there any associated important condition, underlying important condition can be there in such patients?
Sir, there aortic dissection can present like difference in upper limb blood pressure, sir. But if the patient is having chest pain and associated symptoms, then...
Patient, you said there is a lower blood pressure in one limb, upper limb, than the other. Not the same.
Yes, sir. There is if there is difference, we can suspect aortic dissection, sir.
No, less severe conditions. Aortic dissection is a
very severe condition.
Do you think dissection patient will be there for examination? Do you think such a dissection patient will be there for this examination?
No, sir.
You tell me what is the otherwise. Tell me the reason for difference in blood pressure in your patient.
Can be due to in this patient we are suspecting atherosclerosis, so it is a generalized systemic disease. Or it can be due to the
you have more occlusion or the diameter is low compared to the other limb. My question is, in such a condition, what you can have underlying problems like Steele syndrome.
Yes, sir.
Of subclavian steel syndrome, if the patient uses the same upper limb for some time, he will get
headache,
blackouts, cerebral ischemia. Why? the obstruction is proximal to the subclavian. Get stealing of the blood pressure, blood from the cerebral circulation through vertebrals, and you get blurring of vision and ischemia. Very important. So you are leading the examiner to ask questions. Then difference of more than 20 in either one of the limbs means you have to explain, probably due to the atherosclerotic occlusion. The artery may be having a 50 or 60% narrowing, or isn't it? Similarly, you get coronaries, carotids, vertebrals. Very important. Okay, carry on. As sir said, we can go to the management. Sri Kumar.
Yes. How do you investigate this patient? What are the possibilities it comes from now? You investigate, you examine the patient, and what are the possibilities? Critical limb is, what's a critical limb? Before going to investigation, this one question. What is critical limb?
Critical limb means
conditions which say, or the criteria about to say, what are the criteria to say it's a critical limb or not?
Sir, there is rest pain, then angle pressure less than 50, toe pressure less than 30, ABPI less than 0.5. There is tissue loss in the form of ulceration or gangrene.
Yes, so this patient is a critical limb. So such a patient is there, what are the possibilities?
Sir, it is a peripheral occlusive arterial disease with level of occlusion at the at femoral popliteal segment. And we are suspecting etiology as...
Any other possibilities? Opposite limb is almost normal.
Sir,
the pulse are normal.
Sir, people pulsations in the lower part, posterior tibial and anterior tibial.
Okay, other than occlusive disease, any other possibilities?
In another way, ask this question. Suppose this patient was having some ischemic pain, claudication, for say 25 meters. One fine morning, he develops sudden onset of pain, rest pain. Which condition you will think of?
It can be due to an embolic obstruction of
embolism. One is embolism.
Thrombosis of the vessel.
Have bleed, ulceration.
Can be an atheroemboli or
even a popliteal artery aneurysm rupture. Popliteal artery aneurysm may be there.
Artery aneurysm rupture.
So you have these possibilities are there. So how will you investigate this patient?
After the routine blood investigations, I'll go to.
What is the routine? What is the routine?
You said he's on statins.
Yes, sir. He's on statin. So I will look for, as a routine, I look for his hemoglobin to rule out anemia. And I look for blood sugars, then fasting.
Is bored? Is bottle anemia good for the patient or bad for the patient?
Sir?
Is it a bottle anemia? Is it this patient is having pallor? So is it good for the patient or bad the patient?
Bad for the patient. It will add on to the hypoxia, sir.
But if it's a bodily anemia, that's good for the patient because thrombosis is less with the bodily. If the HB is more than 13 or 14, there's a more chance of thrombosis. So if it's 8 or 9, that's good for the patient. If it's below that, it's an hypoxia. Okay, then. So you do a blood routine?
I'll do a renal function test.
For what?
Because, sir, I'll need to do an angiogram if I'm planning for an intervention. So
okay.
I have to know his renal status.
The most important investigation.
Before angiogram, what will you do?
Sir, we will go for a Doppler, sir. Duplex scan.
In the blood of aortas.
Any other blood test in this patient? Patient is on long-term statins.
Important blood test.
Lipid profile,
yes. It was a long-term complication of statins. Any particular organ is affected?
Liver function
disease. Yes, it can produce cholestasis. So, on patient with long-term statins, you have to assess the liver function. Liver enzymes.
His ESR is 140. As a part of routine examination you did, the ESR is 140 in this patient. He'll think about any other condition also.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Means chronic inflammations. Chronic infection inflammation. So, any condition which will, yes.
Tuberculosis.
Tuberculosis affecting blood vessels. Is it possible?
No.
What is the most important condition affecting entire blood vascular system?
Vasculitis.
Yes, sir.
Okay. What are the common vasculitis? Just for.
Just the name. Arthritis.
Yes, Takayasu's arthritis.
What is Takayasu arthritis in this patient? Which point is against Takayasu's arthritis in this patient? Very simple.
Upper limb palsy is palpable,
sir. Age of the patient.
He's very old. 75.
Yeah, usually in young.
Young patients.
Teenagers, isn't it?
So come on, now the time for our discussion of the management.
Okay.
So investigation side, yes, you said the Doppler. What are the points you look for Doppler?
Sir?
What are the points you look for the Doppler?
I'll look for the flow. If there is any turbulence, then I look for if there is any thrombus, any occlusions, then the...
You will identify the block, the level wound. Of block.
Pardon?
Yes, sir.
You look for the turbulence, then you look for the vessel.
Yes, sir.
You look for the turbulence, you look for the vessel, then?
And any extra, any aneurysms?
Is a combination of ultrasound and Doppler, isn't it? So it
yes, sir. Beam on ultrasound and Doppler.
Hypo.
Then in the blood flow value, what do you look for?
We can look for the flow rate.
Flow rate means is it velocity?
Velocity, sir.
What's the velocity?
If there is stenosis, then the velocity will be increased.
So you look for a jet defect in the blood vessels. Okay. Or the velocity is there. Okay. Then site of obstruction, length of occlusions, and ABP also. Yes, Ajay? So this.
Yes. Sinha sir, anything you want to add? Ajit Sinha sir.
Yes, sir. What about...
We are now in investigation.
Why not management? MRI, MRNGO also after Doppler. Before
yes,
deciding
sir, Doppler, if we are if we are planning for an intervention, we will do a CT angiogram, sir.
Why not?
So what are the angio options and how will you select it?
So we can do CT angiogram, MR angiogram, and digital subtraction angiogram also.
So which one you select?
For this patient, I'll select CT angiogram, sir.
Why?
Because we are suspecting an obstruction above the popliteal level.
Above the pupil level, that's good. So below the pupil level?
It is better to offer MR angiogram.
MR angiogram. So the thing is, if you are suspecting a below knee segment, you go for look MR angio. Above knee segment aortic, you go for CT angio. And if you're planning for an intervention along the angiogram, you go for a conventional DSA. Okay. If this patient has a creatinine of 1.8, what are precautions? Will you do an angiogram straight away or? Do some precautions.
No, sir. I will admit the patient 2 days before the angiogram. Then I will start on N-acetylcysteine and I will properly hydrate the patient. And after that only, I will go for angiogram. And after the procedure also, I will keep the patient admitted and will continue hydration. And if there is any acute renal injury occurring, then I will also confirm that there is a facility for an emergency dialysis.
But if MR angiogram is safe for high creatinine?
Yes, sir. It is less likely to produce a renal problem, but there is occurrences for renal injury. There can be a late renal injury called gadolinium kidney.
Very good. Okay.
Ajit sir
is asking something.
Your investigation.
Yeah, once you have decided that you have to do a reconstructive surgery, then what are the options available to you?
Sir, if the obstruction is a smaller segment one, then we can try for an endovascular procedure. And if it is more than 3 centimeter, then we can go for an open surgery, sir.
What do you mean by open surgery?
I will do for this patient, as the obstruction is in the femoropopliteal segment, I will go for a femoropopliteal bypass, sir. Bypass graft.
What will you use for the graft?
Since it is an intra-inguinal lesion, I'll use reverse saphenous vein graft or in situ graft.
So what are the problems of reverse saphenous graft?
Sir, the it can get thrombosed.
Anything can be thrombosed, but saphenous vein is the first contraindication. Thrombosis. If you look at the thrombosis rate, what's the position of if you put the different grafts in a stable, you got a thrombosis.
And then the saphenous vein. Saphenous vein is better, sir, because it is having the mild antithrombogenic effect also. So it is less thrombosis.
Question is, what are the complications of complications of saphenous vein?
Sir, I don't know, sir.
Yes. The point is, what is the availability of thrombosis vein, whether saphenous vein is available or not.
Sir, if the patient undergoes CABG, prior, CABG or prior graft taken, then we cannot take that.
Whether it is available or not, will you take it from the same limb or the different limb?
Different limb, sir.
Different limb.
The 2 points. We'll consider on deciding on graft. One is, as RC said, availability. Second, the condition of the opposite limb. It is almost ischemic in most of the patients. So you don't want to make a incision and leading to poor healing, ulceration, and other things. Okay.
Why you are not taking, why you prefer the opposite limb?
Sir, if we are making an incision in the same limb that is distal to the obstruction, it can go into a non-healing ulcer.
Why you are taking go distal to the obstruction? Distal to the obstruction.
You should never take distal to obstruction.
Because you are taking parallel vein parallel to the artery. The same area vein is taken.
Sir, the entire limb will be having ischemia, sir.
Entire limb is having ischemia. Anything else?
We have to make 2 incisions in the same limb at the same time. So it will be.
The point is, there is no concrete proof that we have to take the opposite limb. One point is, if the patient has a distal decision for a future, we are following an in situ graft that is the same graft, the same limb is comfortable. So if you have a femoral bypass this patient, and later he does the infrasubclavian segment, where you can try for a in situ graft if the vein is available, that can be used. And a second method, second point is, there is one method of arterializing the vein in a no option vessel. If this patient develops a femoral bypass graft, after 3 years he's coming back with no artery distal to it, there also you can try the arterialize the vein using the foot arteries. That also possible only if this vein is present. And regarding the wound healing, though some theory says there's a delayed wound healing, but there is not much proof that there's a delayed wound healing affected limb or not. So these are 3 points by which you prefer the opposite limb, but there is no hard and fast rule that you go for the opposite side. Okay, if you're doing an angiogram, what are the points you look for?
I look for the level of occlusion,
yes.
Extent of occlusion, nature of occlusion, okay. And proximal condition of the proximal vessels, that is running and distal runoff also, sir.
And the length of the
collaterals.
What is your distal runoff? Mostly, what is distal runoff?
The patency of the distal vessel, patency of the vessels artery distal to the occlusion.
And what is why it is significant in this patient?
Sir, Sir, if we are doing a revascularization procedure in this patient, we have to get at least 10 centimeter distal runoff.
Yes, very good.
For the graft to work.
Yes, exactly. Very good. So, at least 10.
Now, what will you do with the great toe, which is already gangrenous?
Sir, as it is a dry gangrene, I will not intervene now because if I go for an amputation, first of all, the wound will not heal. And the gangrene may extend upwards. So I will go for the revascularization procedure first, sir. After that, we can go for the either the gangrenous part will follow up on itself, or we can go for the amputation.
Local
amputation. When will go for amputation? How much time will wait?
Sir, after revascularization.
Blood tissue. Gangrene, yes, means blood tissue. What is the definition of gangrene?
That is macroscopic death of tissue along with putrefaction.
Without putrefaction. So you will keep the gangrenous tissue there. You mentioned that the line of demarcation is there.
Yes, sir.
What is the importance of line of demarcation? What is line of demarcation?
It is a zone of granulation tissue in between the viable and non-viable tissues.
So well-developed line of granular tissue is there. Will you keep that? So the gangrenous toe.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll wait for it to fall off on itself. If we intervene now, if we do an amputation now, it will end up in a non-healing ulcer for the revascularization.
So
you will try to revascularize the limb first.
Yes, sir.
What is the task criteria?
Sir, transatlantic inter-society consensus classification, sir. There is four classes.
What?
Yes. A, B, and C.
What
and
are the parameters? What are the parameters inside the classes?
Sir, the involvement of aortoiliac vessels.
What are the parameters? What are the parameters you look for to make it four classes?
Extent of stenosis, extent of occlusion, extent of stenosis, and complete of occlusion, or if it is complete occlusion or stenosis, and the involvement of common iliac vessels, external iliac vessels, and common femoral vessels. Length of the occlusion, sir. If it is less than 3 or less than or equal to 3 and 3 to 10 centimeter, in both cases the management is difficult, sir. Different, sir. And according to the task classification, we will decide on whether we want
the answer is not complete. One is site of involvement, one is, second is length of involvement, type of involvement, that is stenosis or occlusion.
Yes, sir, occlusion. Then
one more criteria. Number of segments.
Yes, number of
segments. Where is one segment or multiple segments?
Multiple segments.
Difference.
Yes, sir.
Depending on that, how many classes it is divided to?
Four classes, sir. A, B, C, yes, and D.
What's the importance of these four classes in management?
Sir, usually we will go for endovascular management for A, and to some extent for B also. And for C and D, it will be preferable to do an open procedure.
Okay,
so Joji, sir, any comments? Joji, sir, regarding the investigation treatment.
Will you think of endovascular treatment?
This patient, yes, sir.
Why?
Sir, first of all, I'll do an CT angiogram. If it is coming under the criteria for the endovascular procedure, and then I'll, that is, if the segment is less than or equal to 3 centimeter, then I'll go for endovascular procedure, sir.
Okay.
So you surgically vascularize the endovascular procedure, open or endovascular?
Endovascular.
But what are endovascular procedure do?
balloon catheter angioplasty, sir.
What is POBA?
It is a new technique, sir, actually.
It's all technique.
You will only use the angioplasty or you will use the stem? The stenting will use?
I will put a stent, sir.
When you will put the... yes.
Yes, sir, always.
Always put stent in lower limb. What is the criteria on deciding on putting stent?
It depends on the segment or like that.
All infrapropriety lesions, you will put stent after angioplasty?
No, sir. No, sir. No, sir. For infrapropriety lesions, we will usually will not put.
Okay. What is the problem of putting a stent in infrapropriety region?
Sir, the vessel wall, size of the vessel will be problem, sir. Diameter of the vessel.
Not only the diameter. The rate of flow, the velocity is less and more chance stent occlusion. Okay, suppose Mohsin.
Mohsin, what is POBA? Is plain old balloon angioplasty where you put a balloon alone and apply pressure to dilate it without stent. That's one of the oldest concepts. Okay. Yes, plain old balloon angioplasty. And what are the indications of doing a stent in the lower limb?
Supraproclitic lesions.
Probably long lesions, yes. Dissection of the vessel during angioplasty. Recoiling, if that is you are doing angioplasty once, twice, again, it is going to same status, recoiling. These are the indications where you put a stent. Otherwise, stent is not advocated for a lower limb, particularly in the infrapropriety segment, as Dr. Rajan said. Stent is not the primary treatment.
Oh, so can you mention, how will you do a angioplasty, this balloon angioplasty procedure?
Just tell me. Cannulate the femoral artery using the Seldinger technique.
What is the anesthesia?
Local anesthesia, sir.
Local anesthesia, okay. Then?
Then I will cannulate the opposite limb in the femoral artery using Seldinger technique. And I will cannulate the opposite limb, right-sided femoral artery. And as reaching the occlusion, we will
ask how will you remove the embolo in the leg? We use in Fogarty. What is the procedure? Under local anesthesia, where will you expose?
Expose the common femoral. Sir, embolo to common. I'll do an incision to expose the common femoral and yes. Introduce the Fogarty's catheter.
And how many times will you introduce? How will you?
Sir, until we get a good flow.
Good flow. How will you assess the good flow?
So we can.
Can say back flow.
Yes, back flow. We can see back flow.
Or a perioperative utilization of your Doppler. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Regarding the angioplasty, what is a glass staging system? It's a new concept. GLASS.
Sorry, sir.
It's a global anatomic staging system to decide the angiographic procedures in a peripheral vascular disease. Okay.
So here you'll do what these one you'll do a endovascular procedure. Secondly, open surgery you mentioned. Any other revascularization?
So there's a group called no option patients. You have done an angiogram, nothing is possible, angioplasty is not possible, but still you want to avoid amputation. What are the options? Options in a no option vessel.
Sir, in earlier days, there was,
nowadays, today also, it's
modern,
and also we are using it. In all cases, you cannot do angiogram, you cannot do angioplasty, in all cases, you cannot do bypass. The criteria may not be satisfying. So today also, you have to think about some measures to save the limb.
Sir, we will do that general measures like Burgess.
What
exercise.
Are the measures?
Burgess exercise.
This patient will have more exercise.
Will he be able to do exercise?
Yeah, anger is there.
He is having breast pain. So
breast pain.
Yes. And we'll give him.
For this patient, I've done a CT angiogram. There is no single vessel seen below the femoral femoral segment.
So then, how will you manage?
Straight away do amputation.
No, sir.
What are the medical management?
What are the pharmacology management, Mohsin?
We can go for. We can give him antiplatelets, aspirin and clopidogrel, and cilostazol.
What is cilostazol?
It is a PDE3 inhibitor, sir.
Yes. Okay. It's the commonest complication of PDE3.
Headache, sir. It is headache.
Okay.
Any contraindication?
In cardiac patients, it is common.
Which cardiac patient? CAD?
No, sir.
Cardiac failure.
Heart failure.
Yes, cardiac failure.
Antiplate, you use a dual antiplate or single antiplate? Which will you use?
Single antiplate, aspirin.
Why are not you using dual?
Aspirin has got effect on the pain also. It is
an only after revascularization, you can better do a these dual antiplates. Srikumar, am I correct?
Yes, yes.
Dual antiplates,
yes.
Or single antiplates.
Studies say single antiplate. Dual antiplates are benefits only on neurologic issues. Preferably single antiplates. Mohsin, what are other options? One is your cilostazol, then?
Then we have to continue statins. He is using atorvastatin, but it is better to go for rosuvastatin, sir.
So what's the advantage of statin this patient?
It will help to stabilize the plaque already formed, and it will decrease the progression of the disease, sir.
Okay, it's a plaque stabilizing agent. Okay, I agree. That is this is a very important critical limb. You cannot maintain on aspirin problem in this patient. You need to give something else.
I will advise him to walk for at least 45 to 60 minutes.
This patient, it's your patient.
Okay, sir.
Any prostaglandins?
Pendoxifen.
Prostaglandin even, sir. Prostaglandin even. I have prostaglandin. In pendoxifen, you mentioned this is used nowadays.
It is not used nowadays.
How will you give PDE1?
Alprostaglandin, sir.
How will you give? That's the company name. How will you give it?
We will give for 10 hours.
10 hours for?
For 3 weeks.
3 weeks.
I'm not sure, sir.
What's the strength of one ampoule, one vial?
I don't know, sir.
One vial is 500 micrograms. You have to give 100 micrograms once a day or twice a day. What's the commonest complication of PDE1?
Sorry, sir. I don't know.
Kemberg is profound hypotension. So it should be careful about hypotension. Then any other agents?
Any other latest revascularization agents? Any other drug other than you mentioned the surgery, endovascular procedure, any revascularization agents? How about stem cell revascularization? What is that? Stem cell revascularization. Yes, stem cell from the bone marrow you can take. Then you can use either intraarterially or into the gastrocnemius muscles. I think that is the recent advance, stem cell revascularization. Other revascularization examiners discuss. Very good. And one question I want to ask. What are the other actions of these your statins? One is anti-cholesterol. Any other actions? Statin can be given in the venous thrombosis or aneurysm. How it is functioned? not only they reduce the cholesterol. How useful for the post thrombotic limb?
So it is preventing the progression of formation of thrombus.
Now, what is the mechanism?
It is
another pleiotropy effect of statins. One is the can treat the renal failure, especially contrast induced renal failure. You can treat aneurysm, it prevent the expansion. It is action on the endothelial cells and stabilization of the these smooth muscles. And these are things also you can mention the statins. I think there is time for conclusion. Other examinations, further contribution. Ajit sir.
Ajit sir. And very good discussion for the postgraduate. I think good case. The peripheral vascular disease is always a postgraduate is scared about it. So it's a good thing to know about it. And a little more detailed examination to that.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
And.
Mohsin, two more points. No option. The historic limb is a historic all concepts. One is lumbar sympathectomy, and second is omentoplasty. It's not you being.
Omentoplasty.
Yes. Otherwise, I'm quite happy about you. You have a good concept about vascular disease, and you mentioned you answered most of the questions. You prepared a history with you alone, or you have somebody helped you? Did you prepare the history and exams alone, or has somebody helped you?
Alone, sir.
It's excellent. So, as far as the history examination discussion, you performed very well. Congratulations. Thank you.
As Srikumar mentioned, always old examinations ask about the lumbar sympathectomy and omentoplasty. Nowadays, not
used. No, sir. No, sir. Initially, he said these are some old techniques of no option. Because what? Then he said the new techniques. So I said these old techniques.
One more than old technique that Elisar or technique of reverse
palliation. Yes. Yes.
That also not used nowadays. But lumbar sympathectomy, no.
In Calicut, we have done some few cases with even Dhyan sir was there, even Gopi sir was there. A few cases, it is allowed, but results are not so.
If somebody asks, they should answer. That's all. About lumbar sympathy. Which are the ganglia you are going to remove in the lumbar sympathy, Mohsin?
2, 3, and 4, sir.
2, 3. Where is the first ganglia situated?
Yes.
L1 situated where? Well, below the crest of the diaphragm and the right side in the posterior IVC, left side posterior to the aorta. And what are structure you can confuse with the lumbar sympathetic trunk?
Small lymph nodes in the paraaortic area and
lymph node and lymphatic
band of the psoas muscle.
Psoas minor muscle. It can be confused.
Okay.
We can confirm. Ajay Kumar, anything else? Ajay Kumar, Joy sir.
We have completed almost everything, sir. It was an excellent presentation, Mohsin. We have prepared well. One last question regarding the effect of lumbar sympathectomy. Lumbar, so I am not asking the question, I am making a comment. Lumbar sympathectomy was done left and right in our house time and all for all Burgers disease KOs. But still, there is a role for lumbar sympathectomy even now, especially in peripheral occlusive vascular disease, where there is a very high component of sympathetic overactivity. There are a set of patients who will be benefited by lumbar sympathectomy, that they remove the sympathetic overactivity, then they increase the cutaneous vaso, I mean cutaneous circulation. They remove the vasospasm and it relieves pain as well as promotes ulcer healing in a selected set of patients. It is not totally obsolete. There is a role for lumbar sympathectomy.
It helps in rest pain also.
Yes, sir. Because the cutaneous nerves are very painful. So there is some amount of vasodilatation and the rest pain as well as the ulcer healing. But there is a role. We have had patients, I don't know whether R.C. Srikumar will remember. He had one patient where we did revascularization. Still the pain was, actually R.C. was doing it. And the pain did not relieve. Patient's name is Madanan. And finally, we did a laparoscopic lumbar sympathectomy and the pain completely disappeared. It is more than 5 or 6 years. So there is a role for lumbar sympathy.
Okay. Now we'll go to our
one comment, sir.
Okay.
Sir. Nobody has stressed about telling him to quit smoking. That's a very, very important factor.
And very good. Very good.
So we must emphasize to all the patients of peripheral vascular disease that they should not smoke anymore. You know, somehow either they should be counseled or some kind of treatment should be given to quit smoking. You know, that's a very, very important part of the treatment. Otherwise, even if you revascularize, it is likely to get clogged again.
Okay. Our program is not over. Two more person. Our stalwarts, the dancer and the others are waiting. I'm going to dancer. Sir, please come in.
Yeah, good evening, Dr. Gopi. It's very nice to see a set of stalwarts in the examination panel. And nice of you, Dr. Ajit Sinha. Very nice to see you. And Ajay Kumar. Sri Kumar and Dr. Joji. Regarding the candidate, he has done reasonably well. In fact, very well for that matter. He's a second year student. So for his stage of his training, he has done a peripheral vascular disease pretty well. One thing I would like to comment upon is that I will just sum up that the peripheral vascular disease basically present with pain, painful ulcers, and sometimes gangrene. Now, in the clinical evaluation, it's more relevant to identify the signs of ischemia, the site of occlusion, which can be easily identified from history or clinical or imaging-wise. And you have to concentrate on comorbid conditions involving the cardiovascular system primarily, the pulmonary system, as well as the renal system, because it's very important in investigation part. Now, regarding the classification of lower limb ischemia, I thought that the candidate could have mentioned about Fontaine classification. The presentation will be a grade 4 Fontaine, which he did not mention. He has to have a little more theory support, which he requires. Now, in investigating, I used to teach this way. In investigation, the pump is very important. It was not mentioning anything about the heart, because the circulatory disorders, the pump, the vessel, and the blood, these three components are so very important. In the blood, the formed elements, as well as the plasma. All these things are very, very vital in investigating. So in an echocardiogram, and as you do all and sundry on the vessels, and you got an ejection fraction of 20-25, your results may not be pretty good, which of course will come into the various classification in the transatlantic, et cetera, which Vishay Kumar was talking about. Now, in the principle of treatment of peripheral vascular disease, yes, the basic principle is to get the area revascularized, no doubt about it. How can we do general measures, as Professor Sinha was talking about? No one mentioned about smoking. The general measures is very important, smoking, trying to adjust the exertions, etc. And the medical measures, we have got vasodilators, if talking about prostacyclines, the antithrombotic, both thrombolysis and prevention of thrombus, and the minimally invasive procedures. Everything has been covered up. And finally, the open surgical procedures. Very good of Dr. Sri Kumar, because he's a vascular surgeon, and has contributed very much to the benefit of the student. I think I end up there, and it has been a very nice presentation. I would consider the candidate a very good candidate since he has made his own attempt to present and face the examiners. Well done, Mohsin. Thank you very much, Gopi.
And also,
Mohsin. It was a nice presentation, and good evening all. A question to you. What is the treatment of rest pain? The patient has got severe pain. What is the treatment?
Initially, we will give NSAID, sir.
Nothing. He is not having any relief, severe pain. What will be the
treatment? We will step up onto lower up opioids.
And then?
Even then, opioids, sir.
No,
lower opioids, sir.
No, 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 no relief.
Then we will give higher narcotics.
No, the ideal treatment will be epidural. You can give
epidural anesthesia. It is recently seen as got good effect.
Suppose your patient is developing wincing abdominal pain and constipation. What do you suspect?
Mesenteric ischemia can be there.
Mesenteric ischemia. So in such cases, you should also ask for abdominal pain.
Yes, sir.
Usually, wincing type of abdominal pain and constipation, all those things you should ask. Suppose your patient is having very high creatinine and the creatinine is not coming down. Any other option, any type of other type?
Sir, we can do carbon dioxide angiogram. Sir.
Carbon dioxide angiogram. Very good. So carbon dioxide angiogram is an alternative method of angiogram. And you were most of the time talking about exercise. It is a treatment for claudication, not for rest pain. Treatment for claudication is stop smoking, keep walking. So that is the dictum. Stop smoking and
keep walking.
Then the presentation was good, and I hope that you will do well in your exam also. So thank you, Mohsin. Thank you, examiners, and especially our Ajit Singh sir is the external examiner, and all our internal faculty, Ajay Kumar, Joji, R.C. Sri Kumar, and of course, our veteran, E.V. Gobi.
Thank you, sir.
And thank you, Rajan, who nicely summarized. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob, sir.
Hello, Ajit, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much for your long journey from Gurugram to Calicut.
Yes.
Here, further also, you are expecting your cooperation. And yes. Also, Dan sir, Dayandu sir, and R.C. Sri Kumar, Joy sir, and Ajay Kumar, our new professor in Calicut. And thank you very much for the active participant students and other faculties. Again, on the Sunday, we will meet the next Sunday, the same time. The topic will be, I think, next is the, again, vascular topic, varicose vein, by Government Medical College, Periyar.
Okay. Thank you, Gobi sir, for the wonderful opportunity, and all the best, Mohsin, for wonderful.
Thank you very much for everybody.
It was excellent.
Okay. Nice.